Good morning and welcome back to Scientists and Explorers Live with Encounter EDU. My name is Jamie and it's fantastic to have you all with us. We've got homeschoolers, we're all homeschooling now. We've got people watching from the UK, USA, Greece, Australia, Bermuda, India, Ukraine, Cyprus, Malawi and Ireland. So a massive good morning or good afternoon, depending on where you are, to everybody watching. It's really fantastic to have you with us. I'm just going to check on the live chat and on the dashboard to see if we've got any special shout-outs. So we have Isla Sampson and Peter, who are homeschooling in Cumnor, Oxford. Massive good morning to all of you guys there. We have Elliot, age 8, and Henry, age 6, who are currently attending dad school in their living room in Market Deeping in Lincolnshire. Good morning to everyone who's doing dad school or mum school or someone else school. And a big good morning to Oscar from Anglesey. Good morning to you. And just on the, we've got Henry and Owen from Oxfordshire. We've got EV9 and Albert 6 in Bath in UK. Good morning. And we have Cannonby Primary School, all listening from home. And we've got, did I say good morning to Charlie and Matilda yet? If not, good morning. Charlie, age 9, and Matilda, age 6. So, and welcome to Lorenzo as well. So, fantastic to have you on board. I'm so looking forward to penguins and coral reefs. I've got no idea what they have in common. I put myself in the Arctic today. At the other end of the planet, but having had the delight of meeting penguins, my favourite funniest animal, and looking at coral reefs, I'm delighted that very, very soon we're going to go all the way over to Perth in Australia to hear from Murray about penguins and coral reefs and what they have in common. Before that, just to go over a few structural hints and tips and all that kind of stuff. So we're going to have an amazing talk in just a few minutes, and that will last for about 20 minutes or so, and then we'll have chance for Q&A. Now, if you haven't submitted your questions on the Encounter EDU website, don't worry, we'll go through those first, but do use the live chat. Now, the live chat is on YouTube. A lot of you have found it already. And because it's using YouTube as social media, it's important that an adult, like a parent or carer, helps out with that. So we're not really saying that, you know, young people should be getting on to YouTube. You do need your own channel, so hopefully you can get that set up. If you have trouble doing that and you want to just get in touch directly with a member of the team, either for a question, a comment, or just for some tech help, there is a small speech bubble, and that's in the bottom right-hand corner of the Encounter EDU website. So you can get on there, click on there, and a member of the team will be able to help you out on a one-to-one chat. With the live chat, all chats, this is a classroom, however virtual it might be, so try to keep those comments on point, try to keep those questions related to the topic. So hopefully you're all feeling comfortably, you've got everything working, you're ready to begin. We've got Stefano, welcome, who's aged 9 in London, and lots of others who are on here. It's really, really great to have you. And we've got Madison from Connaby Primary in Birkenhead High. And we've got Townsville coming in, which is fantastic, on the other side of the country. But without further ado, over to you, Murray. Can you hear us from Perth?
Yes, I can hear you just fine. Very exciting to hear that so many kids from all around the world are here. I love going into schools and talking to kids, but I can't do that right now because of the COVID virus. So I appreciate this chance to do it virtually. So when I talk to kids, I like to ask a really weird question. So I'm a scientist at the Australian Institute of Marine Science. And what I like to ask is, what do penguins and coral reefs have in common? And since you saw the title of the talk, you might have been puzzling this out and trying to think about it. So often what people say is, oh, penguins and coral reefs, they both live in the ocean. So if that's what you were thinking the answer was, well done, that is true. Another common thing that kids say is, oh, well, they're both alive. And yes, it's wonderful that they're both alive. So that is true as well, but that isn't the answer I was thinking of. So for the rest of this presentation, let's take a deep dive into the world's oceans and try and find out the answer to this perplexing question. So penguins, let's start with them. So the first thing you might think in trying to figure out what they have in common is that maybe penguins and coral reefs are found in the same place on Earth, or maybe they have the same requirements or habitat to survive. So if you look at these penguins, these are Gentoo penguins that I saw in Antarctica in January of 2019. Here's the mom penguin and her baby chick. And you might be able to guess what this white stuff is squirting out of this baby penguin. Penguins are very stinky and very messy. You might have heard of chinstrap penguins. You can see they've got a distinctive black line under their chin, like they're wearing a helmet. And this one is actually getting ready to rocket down a snow-covered slope on its belly. And here's a super cute one running. Penguins are often very dirty because they don't care about cleaning themselves. When you see a nice clean one, it's because they've just jumped out of the ocean and got all white and clean again. They're often quite dirty. Here's an Adelie penguin, which is a clean one. Has the black head with the white line around its eyes. And then here's another Gentoo. So penguins, where do they live? They live in Antarctica. So here we've got the bottom half of the globe with Antarctica at the middle. And everywhere you can find penguins is shown in red. So I often ask kids, what do you think about this map? And they say, oh, well, they're not in the middle of the land. They're only around the edge. And that's right. Everywhere you find penguins is near the coast and really close to the water, because what they like to eat lives in the ocean. So that's things like fish and krill and little crustaceans and squid. And in fact, if they eat lots of krill, sometimes their poo is bright orange from all the krill that they ate. So there's 18 different types of penguins, and you can see that they're also found along the southern portions of continents in the southern hemisphere as well, and that these are places where the water is cold. So they like cold water. If you look at this picture in the background, you can see there's actually whole big chunks of ice floating around in the water. That's how cold it is. And they're perfectly fine with that because they're adapted to the cold. Now, one question kids often ask is, do the penguins help out Santa and the elves? And unfortunately, even though the Arctic on the other side of the globe is nice and cold and icy as well, penguins do not live there, only in the southern hemisphere. So as I mentioned, they make their nests near the sea. So here's a bunch of Gentoo penguins. They nest out of piles of rocks. And then they put their eggs on the rocks. They don't want their eggs to touch the ground because they don't want them to get cold and wet in case it snows, like it is a little bit in this picture. And in the background here, you can see the ship that I sailed on when I went to Antarctica, and this giant glacier as it's abutting against the ocean there and cracking apart as it moves slowly down. If you look really closely, you can see these dark blue lines, which are the cracks of the glacier. So it is freezing. It's the coldest and the windiest continent on Earth, and they love it. Now, what could be more different than coral reefs? They do not live in Antarctica. There's no ice in these pictures. In fact, if it were icy, they would die straight away. The map here, oops, shows you in red where the locations are that coral reefs are found around the world. So Antarctica being on the bottom of the Earth, the coral reefs are located along the equator, which is the fattest part of the Earth, And where it stays warm all the time, even in the darkest days of winter, it's not cold near the equator, and that suits coral reefs just fine. And I've showed these two examples because these are well-known reefs found on the Australian coastal areas. So the Great Barrier Reef, you might have heard of on the Australian East Coast, and Ningaloo Reef, which is a World Heritage Area in Western Australia. But I bet, given where a lot of you are from, you may have seen coral reefs in the Caribbean, at the southern tip of Florida, or maybe even in Hawaii. So they're all over the warm oceans of the world. Here's a beautiful artist's drawing of what a coral reef can look like. You can see it has all different colonies of different sizes and shapes. And they provide habitat to a whole bunch of different other creatures like manta rays and turtles and sharks and lots of amazing colorful fish and starfish and sea slugs and all kinds of things. You'll notice that the water has sun shining through it. So coral reefs like to live in water that's not so deep that the light can't reach, because you'll learn later why they need that. Coral reefs are a bit like Goldilocks and the Three Bears. Remember how Goldilocks was really picky and she only liked her porridge just right? It couldn't be too cold or too hot. Coral reefs are the same. If it's colder than 23 degrees Celsius, they're not happy at all and they might die. And if it's hotter than 29, then they also get cranky, and we'll learn why in a moment. But what we can see from these slides is that it's definitely not true that coral reefs and penguins live in the same places or need the same conditions. They have opposite needs. So that cannot be what they have in common. So what do they have in common? Well, what they have in common is that the Earth and the oceans are getting warmer and warmer due to pollution that we humans are creating every time we create energy. So every time we need to create electricity, unless it comes from solar panels, every time we drive our cars or trucks or ride in an airplane or run a factory, it creates pollution, most notably carbon dioxide, and that enters our atmosphere. And if you're wondering why that should matter, here is our Earth. Our atmosphere is a lovely layer of air, kind of like a blanket. So when the sunshine comes in, that atmosphere blanket traps some of it on the Earth. And that's good, because otherwise we would be freezing cold like they are on Jupiter or Pluto, and we'd be icicles. We couldn't live. Some of that energy at nighttime escapes back out into space. And that's really good too, because otherwise we'd be as hot as Venus, which has a much thicker atmosphere than Earth. And the average temperature on Venus is 300 degrees Celsius. So if that were true for Earth, then we would melt. But the problem is, as we've gotten more and more carbon dioxide and other pollution into our atmosphere, what it does is make the atmosphere better at keeping the heat in. So it's like it's making the blanket of the atmosphere warmer. And it's kind of like when you take plants and put them inside a glass house, and they can stay warm and grow well even in the middle of winter because the glass traps the heat. And that's why it's called the greenhouse effect. So most of the heating that's happened so far to the Earth since the Industrial Revolution, when we started burning coal, has gone into the oceans. And I'll explain that in a second. But first, I wanted to show you a way of actually seeing the pollution, because it's invisible. So people don't realize how it's building up in the atmosphere. So these scientists at this website you can visit, they decided to make each ton of carbon dioxide visible as a giant blue ball. And this is New York City, assuming that the carbon dioxide is coming from one single place and these big blue balls of pollution are coming out. So if you look back after just one day, This is how many big blue balls or tons of carbon have come out of just that one location. And you can see it's starting to eclipse this entire skyscraper. And then if you look at what it looks like for an entire year, you can see it starts to bury the whole city. So that's just from one city in 1 year. So looking at that, you can see how that can quickly build up and why we're getting too much heat. So why do penguins care? Well, penguins, we talked about, they need cold water. The food that they love to eat, fish, squid, krill, those food items, those animals live in places of cold water. And as the water heats up and the ocean currents change and the ice melts, that affects where their food is located, and they can't necessarily find it as easily. So they can starve. And penguins also have an amazing superpower. They are really, really, really good at keeping warm because obviously they need to where they live. So they have blubber. If you look at how roly-poly this emperor penguin is, underneath its feathers, it's got this thick fat that keeps it warm. And they have waterproof feathers. So that's how they can swim in the ice-filled ocean and not get too cold. And that's why the baby chicks can't swim until they molt and get their waterproof feathers. So that's a great superpower to have, but it's no good to you if the water is too hot because they don't know how to cool down. They don't have a cooling down superpower, only a staying warm superpower. And finally, penguins really need ice sheets to rest on because they're constantly, and I can tell you this because I saw it myself when I was in Antarctica, constantly circling around them are skuas and other birds who would like to eat a penguin. And anytime they go into the ocean to look for food, there's orcas or leopard seals, like in this picture, really, really desperately wanting to eat a penguin. Like this poor penguin. So they need ice sheets to be there so they can pop out of the water and rest. But when the water is getting too hot, it's melting the ice. So that's not a good thing for penguins. But what about coral reefs? We already said that coral reefs need the water to be warm. So shouldn't they be happy that the water is even warmer? Shouldn't that make it even easier for them to survive? Well, we have to look a little bit deeper to understand why they get grumpy when the water gets too hot. So that requires, as often happens in science, in asking another question. And the question is whether a coral reef is a rock, an animal, or a plant. And if we were here in the same room, I'd get you to vote and see what you thought. But we'll go through each of these and examine the evidence. So how do you know if something is a rock? One question you can ask is whether or not it's hard, because we all know that rocks are hard. So these things in the picture, there's a live coral here and a coral skeleton here. And in my hand, I have a coral skeleton. If you could touch it yourself, you would be able to feel that it is quite hard. If I were to smack myself in the head with it, I might get a bruise. If you were to surf on a coral reef and crash into one, you could well get a very bad injury. Also, something that's a rock, you would expect to be strong. And coral reefs are some of the strongest things on Earth. Did you know that a coral reef can block up to 95% of wave energy that hits it? So as you have waves coming in, you can see the white caps and the breaking waves here. And then on the other side of this coral reef, there's no wave energy at all. It's blocked it completely. So if coral reefs can do this, they must be strong. So that makes us think that they could be a rock. But let's look a bit further. So if we look from the air at a coral reef, it looks a bit like this, beautiful. If we zoom in to the area in the orange box, it sort of looks like it's made of a bunch of rocks in there. But if you look closer, they're very unusual shaped rocks. And if you zoom in even closer, you get a huge surprise. Actually, all over these apparent rocks are millions or tens of thousands of these tiny little creatures, and they're called coral polyps. So now I'm going to show you a 3D printed coral polyp. And if I open it up, you can see the coral skeleton in white and the tentacles at the top. And in the middle is the body cavity. So it's pretty simple. It looks a little bit like an anemone. So coral reefs are a rock, but they're not just a rock. They're actually a collection of tons and tons of tiny little animals living together on the rock. So how do you know if something is an animal? An animal should be able to do, I think there's seven conditions it's got to do, but two of them are needs to be able to move and it needs to be able to eat. So this is a time-lapse movie of corals, polyps, letting out their tentacles at night and looking for tiny little microscopic things floating in the ocean water that they can grab with their tentacles. So every tentacle, oh, and there's the mouth in the middle. If you see that, if you see the line in the middle of any of these, that's the opening into the mouth. So when something floats by and it brushes against the tentacle, the tentacles have harpoon cells where a piece of their tentacle grabs out and drags in whatever brushed against them. And then they just push it into their mouth. Now that looks really alien freaky, doesn't it? Those tentacles. If you're lucky enough to have a really close-up view of reefs like this and see this, it's amazing. Oops. So that's great, but something doesn't make total sense here. I said that coral reefs can block entire giant waves, yet I've just said that they're tiny little animals and each one might be smaller than your fingernail. If you've ever been to the beach and been smashed and dunked by a wave, like in this picture, you know that it would be crazy to think that a tiny little creature the size of your fingernail wouldn't get smashed by waves. And in fact, coral polyps have a superpower of their own, just like penguins do, except theirs is they know how to make their own rock, which is an external skeleton. So the minute a baby coral called a larvae can settle and attach to something hard, it does that. And then it never stops squirting out a cement. So just like a spider makes a web, a coral polyp makes a cement that over time builds a bigger and bigger rock for it to sit in. So instead of having a backbone inside, it has a skeleton on the outside so that it stays safe. And these pictures are all different coral skeletons from a collection at work. So if you see these little holes in the coral skeletons, that's actually the spot where a coral polyp used to sit. And so different species and growth forms of corals have different little holes. And I'll just show you again this. Oops. So if you can see the little holes on here, every single one of these little holes used to have a coral polyp sitting on it when it was alive. So, but I said that corals are animals and they can feed with their tentacles. And what I do when I go into classes of students is I get everyone to pretend to be a coral polyp and wave their tentacles, close their eyes because coral polyps do not have eyes, and then I throw out jelly snakes for them to try to catch, just like the coral polyps try to catch food in the water. But to make it realistic, what I should do, and this is what I tell the kids, is they should wave their tentacles all night long. And their parents shouldn't give them any dinner. And they should do that, you know, for 8 hours straight and maybe get one jelly snake at the end. Because a lot of times that's what it's like for the coral polyps. It's very tiring for them to feed with their tentacles, and they're not guaranteed to get anything. So to get around that, corals have another superpower. So even more superpowers than penguins. They actually have a best friend, which is an organism that in the billions finds a secure home inside the coral's body. And in exchange does something very important for the coral. So this friend is a photosynthetic algae. The coral's body is clear, as you can see in this picture. You can see right through it. And you can see its best friend, these tiny little things inside. And they have a really, really awesome name, which is zooxanthellae. And I bet if you go and tell that to your teacher or your mom or your best friend, they probably never heard of that word in their life. It's one of the few words with both a Z and an X in it. So the zooxanthellae best friend actually can do photosynthesis, which is just taking the sun's light and turning it into sugar. So they do that, billions of them inside one coral polyp, and they constantly feed the coral sugar. And that gives the coral 80 to 90% of its energy. So it only gets a tiny amount of energy from feeding with its tentacles. And because the coral is see-through, it's the zooxanthellae that makes each coral so colorful, like in these pictures here. So without their zooxanthellae, they wouldn't have these brilliant colors. Which takes us to the problem, which you've been probably wondering. We still haven't said why the hot water is bad. So the reason why it's a problem is that the zooxanthellae are really sensitive to temperature. So if the ocean temperature gets more than 1 degree Celsius too hot compared to normal, and that lasts for 4 weeks, then the zooxanthellae best friend starts to produce poison as well as sugar. They don't mean to, but it's just that heat makes them do it. And that starts to really hurt the coral polyp, and they start spitting out the zooxanthellae because it hurts them too much. And in this little picture here, you can see a mist coming out of this coral polyp, and that mist is made of millions or billions of little zooxanthellae that the coral is spitting out. And if you go to the links that were provided with my the advertisement of my presentation, you can watch this happen in a movie. So what happens is, once all the zooxanthellae have been spat out by the coral, you can see through the coral's tissues, and what you're seeing is its skeleton underneath, which is white. And that's why we call this coral bleaching. So it's a problem for the corals, because then the only way they can survive is by feeding with their tentacles. And if they have to do that for too long, they might starve to death. And so this can happen over giant areas of ocean at once, and we call that mass coral bleaching. That happened to the Great Barrier Reef in 2016, 2017, and just now. Field surveys were just done a week ago that showed widespread coral bleaching at the Great Barrier Reef. So now I just want to show you another way of looking at this. So I have some hot water, and I have a smaller version of the polyp. It's made with a 3D printer with color-changing ink. So I'm going to take it and put it in this hot water, and I bet you know what will happen when I drop it in here. So let's see. Get it nice and clear here. Ah, can you see that? It used to be pink, and now it's gone bright white, as if the coral has spat out all its belly. So if I take it out, you might be wondering, you might be feeling worried about the coral and wondering if it can recover if this happens. And yes, it can. If the water cools off in time, it can get new zooxanthellae. So in my other jar, I have cold water, and I bet you can guess what will happen if I drop the polyp into the cold water. So let's do that. I just built it on the computer. Dang. Oh, can you see that now? No. Oh, I'm spilling it. All right, I'll take it out of the water. Didn't even consider that. So see how it's starting to turn pink again? And I'm just going to wipe my computer off. Didn't even consider that I might spill it on the keys. Okay, there we go. Just so it doesn't soak in. So if you wanted to try this, teachers, the recipe for 3D printing this color-changing coral polyp is on the NOAA website, and I can send the link if it's not already with the other links that I gave. So, but if you can't 3D print a coral polyp, there's a really tasty way to do the exact same experiment. So I'm sure everyone has heard of the candy called Skittles. They're sugary and yummy, and they come in different colors with the big S on them, like in the picture. So if you arrange some Skittles on a plate or in a bowl, and then you pour water on them, you'll find that the color and the sugar leach off the outside and float in the water, just like the zooxanthellae do when the water gets too hot. And my 2 8-year-old sons and I thought we would explore this a bit further today. So we timed how long it would take for the color to start leaching out and how long it took for the Skittles to go completely white. And we did that with cold water. And then we repeated it with new Skittles with boiling hot water. And we found that it took 10 seconds with the cold water for them to start to lose their color, and only 5 seconds with the hot water. And then it took more than, I think it was 3 minutes and 47 seconds for all the color to be lost from the cold water, but it only took 58 seconds with the hot water. So Skittles are a little bit like coral polyps in that they lose their sugar and their color really fast if they get exposed to water that is too hot. So any one of you can try that experiment at home, and it's delicious to eat it when you're done. Okay, and then the last thing that I love to do when I go into schools is actually dress up as a coral polyp, because why not? My wonderful friend Libby from the Australian Institute of Marine Science made me this coral polyp costume. So if you look at the picture, on the one side, underneath my tentacles, you can see my body has all kinds of colors on it, and that's from pieces of fabric stuck to me. Stuck to my skeleton with Velcro. And so what I do is I have a big thermometer, a pretend one, and I make the temperature go high, and then I tell kids, oh, it's too hot, my zooxanthellae, they're hurting me, you have to save me. So the kids run up like they are in that picture, and they rip them all off, and that makes me turn white because you can see my skeleton underneath, which is a play tunnel. And then once the water cools off, I change it on the thermometer and I say, please, please save me. I'm starving to death. My tentacles aren't catching enough food. And so they give me new zooxanthellae, and I'm fine again. You can actually watch a video of me doing this. I went on a science show in Australia called Scope, and in the links that are online with my presentation, you can actually watch me underwater, not really, but in a green room. So it looks like I'm underwater and I slowly bleach and then I recover. So check that out if you want. And then I was told that I can actually suggest fun homework for you. So if you watch that video, so if you're going on YouTube, get a mom or dad or a teacher to help you find it. At the beginning of the video, before I bleach, it talks all about a contest I ran called Kids Care About Climate Change. And this was in 2018. And I asked kids to draw what they love most about penguins or coral reefs. And in just 2 months, I got 1,246 drawings from kids from 11 different countries. And I arrange those drawings into the shape of a dabbing penguin. And then we printed it, and it made a banner that was 7 meters by 5 meters. And I took it to Antarctica. So if you guys are really interested in doing a similar drawing about what you love most about penguins and coral reefs, we'll see how many we get. And then we can try and figure out what amazing thing we might be able to do with them. A friend of mine just emailed me 2 days ago, and her friend is an astronaut who's just been into space. So who knows? Maybe we could send your drawings into space. I don't know. But feel free to submit them to the, what's it called? Education? No. Encounter EDU? Okay. I'm happy to answer any questions you guys have.
Thank you so, so much. amazing talk. Wonderful penguins, some of my favorite animals. I love how confused they look when they're on land and how graceful they look as soon as they get into the water. That sort of difference between those two states. And then the coral reef, absolutely amazing. We've got so many questions. It's been amazing. A couple of shout outs that I missed out at the beginning. Madison, age 12 in New York. Hi. Great to have you with us. And I think it's Sheila and Izzy in Portal. So big hello to you too. So let's start off with a confused, potentially confused penguin chick. Kathy and Oscar would like to know, there's so many penguins in a colony. If a baby penguin or penguin chick wanders off and gets lost, how does it find its parents again?
Oh, yeah, it's amazing that penguins can actually recognize each other despite there sometimes being thousands and thousands of penguins. So they might know that emperor penguins, when the egg is comes out, it's actually the dad who holds it on his feet for months and months while the mom goes and eats as much fish as she possibly can so that she builds back her energy. And so when she comes back, she's never even seen her baby before, and somehow she has to find it out of, you know, tens of thousands of penguins. So I guess they are, I'm not a penguin biologist, but my understanding is that they recognize the voice and also the smell of their family members. But little baby penguins that get separated from the rest of the colony are very likely to have trouble with skuas or other birds that are constantly looking for a penguin to eat because they think penguins are the yummiest food ever. So they need to make their way back ASAP.
And it's sounds scary for a penguin chick out there and being sort of dive bombed by a skewer and potentially becoming lunch. I just saw a quick shout out that we had from now it's so many questions coming in, I've now lost it. But Tom and Lottie would like to know, do all penguins live in the snow?
Ah, so no. There are penguins that live on the southern coastal areas of continents in the southern hemisphere. So, for example, in Western Australia, where I live in Perth. About a 40-minute drive south of me is a little island called Penguin Island, and the smallest species of penguin live there. And there's no snow. It never snows in Perth, ever. So they don't require snow. They require the water to be cold. So if there's a cold water current, the nearby land itself doesn't have to be super cold as long as the water is cold so that their food can survive. So yeah, penguin, and there's even penguins living in the Galapagos Islands, which are near the equator. And they only can survive there because the cold water currents are there. So when they get too hot, they jump in the water and cool off.
Very good. Galapagos penguins, so up towards the equator, which is you've got cold water coming past it.
Yes, that's right.
And question here, this is from Tom and Lottie again, was it, can you keep penguins in a lake or a pond, or do they need the ocean?
Ah, that's a good question. I tend to think that they probably would need the ocean. It depends what they eat, whether they could eat freshwater fish instead of the fish that live in the ocean. But if they were a krill specialist, I can't imagine krill growing in a pond. But I can ask. I have two friends that study penguins. So if you save that question for me, I can ask and get back to you.
That would be absolutely brilliant. Thank you. And we can put answers like this up onto the Encounter EDU Twitter account. So parents, mum, dad, teachers can check out at Encounter EDU or try and get as much as possible for those questions up on there in the next hours and maybe a little bit longer. But we're going to go over questions about the coral reef. And we've got several questions coming through about what eats a coral reef. Do humans eat coral reefs? What else? What, you know, does anything sort of have it for lunch?
Ah, that's a very good question. So there's the coral reef structure made up of the skeletons, the coral polyps, and the zooxanthellae inside. But then there's also the many, many, many sea creatures that use the coral reef as their home. But in terms of the corals themselves, sometimes they fight with each other for space, but they don't eat each other, but they can hurt each other because they need to have enough room and they need to not be blocked from the light. So coral polyps have stinging cells and they can sting each other. Corals, polyps can be killed by macroalgae that grows over them and blocks the light, so they starve to death. There are certain fish that nibble on that algae that's sometimes living on the coral, like parrotfish. They're the bright, colorful ones with the big kind of bulging nose. And they're trying to eat the algae, but sometimes they accidentally damage the coral. Let's see. And then all the creatures that live on coral reefs can, of course, eat each other and do all. So if you remember Finding Nemo, Nemo and all his brothers and sisters, when they were just eggs, were in the little rock ledge. And then the barracuda came and ate all of them except for Nemo. So that kind of stuff happens all the time on coral reefs. You get bigger fish eating little fish and whatnot. And then, of course, people eat those creatures as well. We don't eat coral reefs themselves, but we eat the fish that live on them. People in some countries like to eat sea cucumbers, which live around coral reefs, crustaceans like crabs and things. So, yeah, I mean, but the main risk to coral reefs isn't from people eating them. It's from people making energy in ways that pollutes the atmosphere and makes the water too hot for coral reefs. That's the pervasive biggest threat to coral reefs, not getting eaten. But very good question.
Brilliant. And I think also, I think that we've come across maybe one specialist coralivore. So a specialist coral eater.
Of course, the crown of thorn starfish. Yes, sorry. Thank you for reminding me. Yes, so that is a very important one. So the crown of thorn starfish is really cool. We could do a whole presentation just on that. I used to go on field trips where the people were diving underwater and counting and finding the baby crown of thorn starfish. So what it actually does is it finds a coral and it lays its body onto the coral, and then it actually turns its body inside out so that its stomach lays directly on the coral tissue on top of the coral polyps, and then it digests them in place and just sucks their liquefied body up like it's, you know, drinking something out of a straw. And then the other thing is the crown of thorns starfish protects itself with these poisonous spines. So if you're a scientist studying these and trying to count them, you have to be really careful, because if you touch the spine and get spined, it actually hurts. And the more separate times you touch one, the worse it hurts each time. But the bad thing about crown of thorns starfish is that they tend to go in kind of outbreaks or waves. You could think of it like a locust plague. So suddenly you get, if the conditions are just right, like, and we think it has to do with bad water quality, that promotes them to proliferate and make many, 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 many crown of thorns starfish. And if there's plenty of coral to eat, they just explode in numbers and they can just munch their way through a vast amount of coral. So yes, I totally forgot about them. I'm very glad you mentioned that.
Marji, very sadly, that's all we have time for today. It's been wonderful hearing about these two very, very special places on the planet. Thank you so much to all those watching, and a quick last shout out to Riley and then Tom and Lottie as well. We've got two fantastic talks coming up the remainder of this week for Scientists and Explorers Live, and that's with Philip Ball looking at why water is weird tomorrow. And then on Friday, we have Helen Finley looking at ocean acidification, about the chemistry of the ocean. Really great science chat there. We are putting up some more lessons for the Easter haul. So if you are watching and it's all about coral, we're going to do a coral holiday camp, basically a science camp. And there are activities and live lessons every single day, except for the bank holidays, over the Easter haul. So those are going to be going up later today. But for now, thank you so much for being part of Scientists and Explorers Live. Thank you, Marji, so much for dialing in for all the way from Perth. It's been fascinating hearing all about coral and penguins, but it's goodbye for now. Bye-bye.